On behalf of the family, I would like to welcome you all to this service of celebration of life for Martha Everhard. In the face of death, believe the good news the scriptures proclaim. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. We've come together today within the strengthening fellowship of family and friends to share our grief with God and with one another, to remember and give thanks for the incredible life of Martha, to hear again God's promise that light is stronger than darkness and that death does not get the last word, and to commend Martha to God's everlasting care. Let us pray. O God of all, we remember before you this day your child Martha. We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As the musicians come up to take their places, I want to thank the family for helping plan today's service, for picking music and scriptures that were special to Martha, special to her family, and special to her church family and her camp family. So we invite you, as you hear these songs, I'm sure many of you have strong memories that go along with them. And so we invite you to take that trip down memory lane, those times you spent with Martha, and just let God bless you.
Born of the one.
seated. At this time, I'd like to invite Martha's grandchildren to come up, who are going to read our scripture lessons for today.
Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 through 8. There is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to uproot. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to tear down, and a time to build. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search, and a time to give up. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to mend. A time to be silent, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time for war, and a time for peace. He has made everything beautiful in its time. Thank you.
A reading from the Book of Psalm.
I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will not slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time and on forevermore.
So I wanted to introduce this next song that we're going to play. When we asked my Grammy what her favorite song was, or if she had a song, if her and Dick had a song together, she said, of course, it's the song Always. And so every time we would visit her in her last few months, we would play this song, and now we're going to play it again for you.
You've planned, need a helping hand, I will
Before I offer our words of eulogy this morning, I want to share with you a message from our regional church. As you all know, Martha's life of service extended far beyond this family, this community, this church, to encompass the Ohio region, especially all of her years at Camp Christian, where she touched the lives of so many young people. I'm just curious, raise your hand if you were one of those campers of Martha over the years. That's what I thought. So our regional minister, Reverend Alan Harris, sends his regrets that he couldn't be here in person this morning, but he wanted me to read this tribute to Martha. Martha was not only an incredible local church pastor, she was also a dynamic presence in regional church ministry. Her beautiful book, On Holy Ground, 50 Years of Camp Christian, not only reflected her own passion and appreciation for Camp Christian and that of generations of campers and church leaders, it also endeared the legacy of our regional camp, conference, and retreat center in the hearts and minds of our larger church. Martha also provided a compelling role model and mentorship to younger women in ministry during a time when there were few female clergy visible in the life of the larger church. And in 2012, Martha received the Disciple of Merit honor from the regional church. She will be greatly missed and forever profoundly appreciated. Gratefully yours, Alan Harris. There's no way we can capture in our short time together all of the amazing things that encompass the life of Martha Everhard. But I want to thank the family for sharing stories with me. I also have to thank Martha. For at the age of 75, Martha published an autobiography of her life filled with wonderful stories. And I want to share some of those now with you. Martha Jean Mink was born on April 26, 1930. It was about 5 weeks before her due date when her parents, Annie and Franklin, decided to drive from Orange, California to Los Angeles with their oldest child, 20-month-old Mary Virginia, to visit her grandfather. Not long into their visit, Annie went into labor, and they had to pile back into the Model T Ford and drive back to Orange, California. Martha joked that she was born in a rush, and she's been in a rush ever since. By her own account, Martha had a wonderful childhood. Her family lived modestly. Her father, Franklin Mink, was the pastor of a small disciples church, the First Christian Church of Orange, California. And her mother worked at home, raising Martha and her three sisters, Virginia, Melva, and Dorothy. But what Martha had in abundance was a deep sense of love and security, of being cared for and precious to her parents, to her grandparents, to her church family. You see, the parsonage was right next door to the church, and they didn't have aunts or uncles or cousins, so the members of the church were their extended family, those aunts and uncles and cousins. Some of Martha's earliest memories are of sitting in the balcony of the church, snuggled next to her mother, surrounded by this warm, caring community. If she got restless, her mother would take out her hanky and shape it into a baby or kitty or a bunny or a bear to keep Martha occupied. Martha learned many important lessons from her mother, but there was one in particular that she carried with her and she passed on to her Sunday school children that she taught later in life. You see, one evening, she and her big sister, Jenna, were cleaning up after supper, doing the chores. Jenna was washing the dishes, Martha was drying the dishes. And she came across this picture that had been given to her parents as an anniversary present, a very precious, treasured item. And she paused, and she looked at her mom, and she asked, what would happen if she dropped it and it broke? Her mother's response, things are not important. People are. Marcia also had fond memories of visiting her grandparents, Baba and Grandma, who lived on a farm outside of Visalia, California. Memories of being Baba's helper with the chores, of milking Daisy the cow, feeding the chickens, and collecting their eggs. Now, when Martha was still young, the family moved from Orange to Long Beach, where her father accepted a position at Eastside Christian Church. She spent her days there playing with her siblings and the neighborhood children, whether it was games of hopscotch or jacks, kick the can, hide and seek, or just riding bikes around the neighborhood. But Martha's very favorite time of year was the 4 weeks they spent each summer as a family in a rustic cabin in Kings Canyon National Park, a cabin built by her grandfather on an outcropping of rock. It was a very rustic cabin, no running water, no electricity. And there in the shadows of the majestic sequoias, Martha would hike and explore the woods, trying to find and catch lizards and chipmunks, riding tree branches like they were horses, just letting her imagination run wild. One of my favorite stories is the time that she discovered a nest of baby mice and promptly put the nest on top of her head, covered it with a hat, and carried them around for the rest of the day. She continued to visit the French cabin as often as she could over the years, and it was always, always her sanctuary, a place of profound peace and joy for as long as she lived. Now, when Martha was 12, the family moved to Ohio, where her father was called to serve as the pastor of High Street Christian Church in Akron. Now, that first year, Martha was terribly homesick for California and her friends, and it was hard. But things got better when her family moved into a new house on Herman Avenue in southwest Akron. She started a new school, made some new friends. After grade school, Martha attended Buchtel High School. Always a lover of books and reading, she did well in her studies. But high school was much more than academics for Martha. She got involved in as many activities as she possibly could. And those leadership skills were evident at a very young age. She served in several different leadership positions, including on the student council. And upon graduation, she very proudly received the prestigious Womanhood Cup Award. But perhaps the main reason Martha remembers her high school years with such fondness is because it was there that Martha met the love of her life, Dick Everhard. You see, she and her friends were attending a varsity basketball game when she happened to notice this tall, handsome, redheaded player make a fast break down the court. So she asked around a little bit, found out that he was dating someone, but as soon as they broke up, she found ways to pass by his locker when she knew he would be there. They had their first date on January 13th, 1945, and it was Martha who did the asking. You see, her sorority was hosting a sleigh ride party, and Martha decided to invite Dick to attend. She discovered that this cute basketball player was quieter and shyer than she was, but she decided, you know what, that would work out well because she was outgoing and talkative. And it turns out she was right. For a lifetime of a good listener and a good talker made a great pair. Not only that, but just a life of love and support. Martha commented often how grateful she was that Dick supported her in all of her choices and work paths and career paths. And for over 60 years of marriage, they loved and supported each other. Now, after high school, Martha attended college at Akron University. She started out studying to be a secretary, but when her professor pulled her aside and pointed out that she was failing typing, she decided to switch to education. It was a decision she never regretted. All of us know that Martha is a born teacher. Now, her senior year, she worked as a student teacher at Krauss Grade School, and for her, that sealed the deal. She knew that this is what she was called to do. She just loved teaching and loved her students. Now, while at college, like in high school, Martha threw herself into extracurricular activities and organizations. She ended up taking on multiple leadership roles. She was active in her sorority, Alpha Gamma Delta, serving as its president. She also served on the school's student council, and she was awarded the Key Award for Leadership and was inducted into Perion, a club for female leaders at the university. Now, while in college, Martha and Dick kept up their courtship. Dick wrote Martha letters almost every day. This is the day, you know, when calling was too expensive. They would also take turns attending each other's school dances and events. Dick was a student at Western Reserve in Cleveland, of course, Martha at Akron U. And then 2 days after Martha graduated, they were married. After their wedding, the newlyweds moved to Cleveland, rented a small apartment. Martha got a job as a school teacher, while Dick went to dental school. And then in 1954, Martha and Dick welcomed their first child, Robert. They were overjoyed at this precious child that God had blessed them with. After Dick graduated from dental school, the family moved to Pensacola, Florida, where Dick served for 2 years in the Navy, and they lived on the naval base. While in Florida, they welcomed their second child, Jerry, and again, were so delighted by this blessing from God. Now, as Dick's term at the naval base drew to a close, the young family had to decide what to do next. Martha was expecting their third child, Nancy, just a few weeks after Dick's discharge. Should they stay in the Navy for a couple more years, or should they risk it and embark on opening a practice? They decided to go for it. Advice Martha often gave her children and grandchildren over the years when they faced major life decisions. Go for it. Now, both sets of parents were living in Akron, so they knew they wanted to move back to Northeast Ohio, but where? They looked at a few different small towns, including this little town called Wadsworth. The story goes that they stopped by Brenneman's drugstore, found a payphone, looked through the directory to see how many dentists were already serving here, and there were about 6 at the time. I thought, that's pretty good. I think Wadsworth could use another dentist. So Wadsworth it was, and the rest, as they say, is history. Dick got to work establishing his practice. Martha spent her days raising their children and serving her community. As a mother, Martha was very hands-on, active in all aspects of the children's lives. She and Dick attended all their activities, all the different sports that they played, dance, piano, scouting. And she was never pushy about their activities, allowing the children to decide what they wanted to pursue. Some of their best family memories were made on their annual summer vacations. Every year, the family would take 2 weeks and drive to a new destination. I understand that Bob usually sat in the middle because Nancy and Jerry would sort of annoy each other a little bit, so he was the oldest piece and the peacemaker. They would follow that AAA triptych. Martha prepared goodie bags in advance for all the kids to keep them busy. They'd bring along the Coleman stove and stop at the first rest stop to prepare breakfast on the way. Food was actually one of Martha's love languages. And what's interesting, she credits not her mother, who I guess was kind of a so-so cook, but her mother-in-law, who evidently was a very good cook, for teaching her how to become such a good cook. They always had dinners together as a family. Dick would come home for lunch every day. And not only would Martha have food on the table, She would have tidied up the house, picking up all the toys from the kids so that everything was clean when he came home. She made a hot breakfast for the children before school every day and packed their lunches. Now, on the weekends, they were allowed a special treat for breakfast, cold cereal. In my house, it's kind of the opposite. Cold cereal and maybe a hot breakfast was a treat. But back in those days, you know, getting a box of cereal was a special thing. And Martha, always the wise parent, would take the kids grocery shopping. And to keep them, you know, contained while they were in tow, she would promise that if they behaved, they could pick out a cereal before they left. And that was always a big treat. Although on birthdays, I understand, Martha made homemade fritters, which sounds like the best possible treat of all. She loved to bake. There were always cookies stashed in the freezer. At dinner, there was dessert, tapioca pudding, or ice cream. Or her one of her favorites was the mint chocolate chip ice cream pie. And for the holidays, Martha and Dick would always host the extended family for Christmas or Thanksgiving or Easter. Martha would prepare the meal. But they also arranged for regular visits with both sets of grandparents throughout the year, because family was so important to both of them. And so was their vast network of friends and neighbors. Whether it was their first house on Highland Avenue or their second house on Donner Drive, they became close friends with their neighbors. Although, truth be told, were Martha and Dick not the gracious people that they were, things could have played out a little differently when they arrived in Wadsworth. You see, not long after they moved into their first home, Martha was outside playing with the boys, barefoot and pregnant. You know, from the time Martha was a little girl, she hated wearing shoes. Every chance she could, she would go barefoot. So several barefoot stories actually in her autobiography. In addition, Dick had been, you know, recently washing his car in his bathing suit. It didn't take long for the neighbor across the street to call the realty company, asking what kind of hillbillies they had let into the neighborhood. Now, Bill Snoke, who took the call, thought it was really funny. Martha and Dick did not find it quite so amusing. But by the time they moved out of that house, Martha and that neighbor across the street were fast friends, Martha saying she even cried when they moved across town to their new home. One of Martha's greatest joys in life was being a grandmother. Her grandchildren were always such a delight to her, and she would light up every time she got to be with them. Grammy, or Gigi as she was known, was the kind of grandmother who got down on the floor and played. She could be fun and silly, imaginative and curious, but above all, she was loving and encouraging. She was attentive and engaged, responding to each child's interests, like with them making books together, pursuing whatever it was that they were excited and passionate about. And I can't help but wonder if her own experience of being such a treasured grandchild informed how she, in turn, was a grandparent herself. In fact, in her book, she writes about her wonderful grandparents and says, "I pray that I can do the same for each of our grandchildren." Now, I would be remiss if I didn't also take a moment to acknowledge all that Martha did for the community at large. That love and generosity, that service extended so far beyond, again, her family and church family. Martha was a volunteer probation officer for 5 years. She served on the board of directors of the Community Mental Health Services, served on the Business Advisory Council to the Superintendent of Schools, served on the board of hospice for Wadsworth and Rittman. She was invited to be part of the Medical Ethics Committee of the Wadsworth-Rittman Hospital. And of course, she was a counselor for youth at the local high school. And after she went through her own battle with breast cancer, she started support groups that met in her home. In fact, in 1979, Martha was named Citizen of the Year. Martha's most profound years of service, however, I think, were those that she spent serving Christ and his church. And at this time, I'd like to turn the pulpit over to Reverend Jim Singleton to share with you more about this part of Martha's life.
Thank you, Sarah. Prior to my coming, my predecessor, Phil Gould, approached Martha and invited her, asked her to be the ChristianEd director and associate minister. And she said no, but then slept on it and decided, yeah, she would do that, but she didn't want to start. This was like in June, she said yes. She didn't want to start until around September. And Phil said, fine. And then 2 weeks later, Phil had a heart attack. And he asked Martha to come to the hospital. And she went and he said, take care of the church. And so Martha took care of the church. Which brings me to me. If truth be told, I was not supposed to last very long as the minister of First Christian Church, Wadsworth. The regional minister did not even want to put my name in contention here to fill the pulpit because Wadsworth was one of Ohio's premier churches, and I was a 29-year-old with 4 years' experience at two very small congregations. But because Wadsworth had turned down so many previous candidates, he was left scraping the bottom of the barrel, and that was me. Other ministers did not believe I would make it here and told me so to my face. Matter of fact, it was at an area Christmas, regional minister's Christmas party shortly after I had arrived here, that one of the ministers came up to me and said, you know, none of us here believe you will last very long at Wadsworth. Merry Christmas. My predecessor, Phil Gould, had lasted 37 years and was one of the outstanding ministers of the region of Ohio. And anyone following him was a fool and bound to be a sacrificial lamb. I heard that said to me 100 times. And honestly, I wasn't so sure myself exactly what I had gotten myself into. Coming to this church that had Sunday school classes with more people in them than I had in my worship services of two churches combined. Now, I say all of this not to criticize those people for underestimating me. Quite the opposite. I say all of this because they were right. I would not have lasted long here. I should not have lasted long here. But there was one factor that none of us took into consideration. Martha Everhard. There was one request made of me when I was hired. And that was that I would keep Martha Everhard on as my associate pastor. I've made a lot of foolish decisions in my time, but keeping Martha on as my associate minister was not one of them. In fact, it was one of the best decisions I ever made. I rank it right up there with my decision to marry Jan. maybe just a little below, just that much below. I never had a staff before, and coming to Wadsworth immediately gave me a staff of five. I had a secretary, Fanny Kaufman, and I had Martha. Now you may be wondering about the math here. How can I have a staff of five with only two people? And that's because Martha was not only the associate minister, but she was also the Christian education director, the youth minister, and the program director for adults. It soon became apparent to me why the pulpit committee was so insistent that I keep Martha on the staff. As Christian education director, she had orchestrated a Sunday school program that was seeing over 325 people per Sunday in Sunday school attendance. As youth director, she was the Pied Piper of kids who came to this church from all over the area and brought their parents with them just to be part of Martha's youth program. And it was the principal engine for our growth throughout the 80s and early 90s. In fact, I was asked by the region during the regional convention if I would give a program and a talk on how to grow a church. So I came up with this program evangelism. You need program evangel. It was a euphemism for hire Martha Everhard. That's how you grow your church. But it wasn't really the program that attracted all of these kids. It was Martha. Most of these youth had never had an adult treat them with such respect and empathy before in their lives. They could tell her anything, and she would guide them and challenge them, but she would never, ever judge them. She established one of the oldest traditions in this city when 50 years ago she started Search for the Christ Child, which at one time drew over 1,000 people to that. And in the summer, she led a contingent of around 120 CYF and Cairoers to summer camp, where if you ever wanted to know where Martha was at camp, just look for the largest group of kids, and she'd be found somewhere in the middle of them. Martha loved Camp Christian so much she wrote the book On Holy Ground. And whether she was with junior high school, high school, or college young people at camp, those kids felt, whenever they were with Martha, like they were on holy ground. But it was not just youth who flocked to her. So did the elderly. Her Golden Ager programs attracted dozens of seniors that she planned trips for, brought in speakers to educate and entertain, and my personal favorite, every Christmas time, she held an annual Christmas party in her home where she ran around with her apron preparing food and desserts. And there was musical entertainment, but the highlight was when she would gather everyone around her like little kids, and she would read a Christmas story and make us all feel the wonderment of the season. Now, to run all of these programs, she could not do it alone. She had to recruit. And she recruited lots of people. In fact, the old adage was, you can't say no to Martha. And that was true, but it was true not because she applied so much pressure on you to say yes. It was true because she saw in you skills and passions that you didn't know you had until you were asked to be a youth leader or an elder or a Sunday school teacher or any number of ministries that she plugged people into over the years. Because Martha didn't ask you to do busy work. She asked you to do God's work. And you can't say no to God. Martha was more to me than just a staff member. You see, in seminary, I learned how to preach and interpret scripture and think theologically, but not necessarily how to be a pastor. Believe it or not, I'd never seen a wedding or a funeral until I had to do one. And when I came here, I performed them according to the book. Just plug in the name and use the same service. But then I witnessed how Martha did weddings and funerals. She made them personal. No two were exactly alike. And I watched. And I learned, and I grew. Also notice how pastoral she was in making home and hospital visitations. How she would make a passage of scripture seem like it was written for just that person at just that particular moment in his or her life. And I watched, and I learned, and I grew. And I saw how she led meetings and stood up for what she believed in, even when others didn't see it her way. And she could oppose people and still hold their respect. And I watched and I learned and I grew. Martha Everhard was my mentor. And without her, I never would have made it here very long. Because of her, I made it here 36 years. Now, Martha was a whirlwind of activity. But she was also a very spiritually centered disciple. For all of us who knew her and loved her, she was a sequoia tree. Mighty, solid, inspiring, and attracting many people far and wide to come to her. And although this mighty sequoia has fallen, her seeds have scattered and continue to grow and produce new generations of Christians. One of her youth, Megan Lash, now Megan Colasar, grew up and came back to become our youth leader here in order to carry on the traditions and values of Martha, who meant so much to her, and Martha could not have been prouder. Barb Bina, now Barb Schwa, also grew up under Martha and has gone on to become a minister with her husband Stephen in California. And together they wrote a book entitled Free to Be Me. I'd like to read an excerpt from that book. Quote, many of us, Stephen is writing, many of us can remember a good teacher, pastor, or other leader who spoke of life and encouragement to us. When asked about them, we probably get a warm feeling in our heart and a smile on our face. Even if it's been decades since we've seen them, we still remember their name and how special they made us feel. Knowing them and coming under their authority has been a positive factor in our life. That is the power of authority working the way God intends. My wife knew an amazing pastor during her teenage years. Martha was one of the leaders at a camp Barbara attended every summer. Over meal times and during free time, Martha often was found speaking life, acceptance, and encouragement to one of the teen campers. She regularly reached out to individuals who were on the fringes of the group. She had a wonderful way of making everyone she met feel special. And her affirmation carried additional weight because of her leadership role. Being a source of support and encouragement is one example of how leaders can release God's blessings to those around them. Unquote. And I'd like to read one final testimony that I received last week from Jeff Nielsen. Many of you may remember Jeff Nielsen, whom Martha greatly influenced. Quote, I met Martha in 1984 when I was an 18-year-old guy hurt by the breakup of a high school relationship. I walked down the stairs of the education building not knowing where I was going and literally ran right into Martha. She asked if she could help me. I informed her that I didn't want to talk about God or praying or anything like that. I just needed to talk. And instead of tossing me out on my ear, she invited me in to chat. At the end of the hour, not only had we prayed, she invited me to FCC's Monday Thursday service, which started my journey of faith. When I was installed as a minister 19 years ago, Martha came to my installation service. She and Dick traveled 550 miles to share that day with me, and she spoke to my congregation about me. At the close of our time together, she gave me a gift, which I treasure very much. She gave me a plate and a disciple's chalice and said to me, a minister needs his first chalice. I used that chalice she gave me just last Thursday at our Monday Thursday service. And I'll tell you, when I see that chalice, I always go back to the fond memories of my friend Martha. Jeff continues, I and the 10 million other people she had influenced will always cherish the love, respect, care, and yes, I'll even dare say friendship I shared with Martha. She taught me a lot. She hugged me when I needed it. She kicked me in the pants, figuratively, when I deserved it. And she always, always, always had my best interests in mind. Everything she ever suggested I do was to make me a better person. And in many ways, she did make me a better and much stronger person. Unquote. I lived around the block from Martha and Dick, and we talked about her influence beyond these walls and her survival of cancer, and she started a cancer survivor group in her home, and I would go on walks, and oftentimes it'd be on a night when the group was meeting, and cars were parked all the way up the street and around the corner, and it was amazing how many people would come to her home to be with her, pray with her, and just absorb her faith and hope. Martha's favorite passage of all time was Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Her life among us was a witness to the truth of that statement. But like the preacher of Ecclesiastes said, for everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. And it was Martha's time to die. Yes, a mighty sequoia has fallen. But her seeds have scattered and continue to grow and produce the fruit of blessings. They grow in the people we've heard from. They grow in people beyond these walls. They grow in me, and they grow in you. Martha Everhard helped shape who we are and has shown us who we can yet become. God bless you, Martha, and thank you for everything. We all love you. We will never forget you. And we will strive to be as faithful and loving as you always were.
Thank you, Jim. There's not much more to add to what has been said today, but I do want to leave you with one quote from Martha herself. In her autobiography, which, as an aside, so much of Martha's autobiography was actually not about Martha at all. You will not be surprised to learn that page after page was about other people. It was about her family and her friends and their life stories and what was precious to them. Because at the end of the day, that was what Martha's life was here for, was to pour her love into others, as Jim said, so that their lives could go and bear fruit. So I want to read this quote that Martha chose for her autobiography. It's from George Bernard Shaw. Life is not a brief candle. Rather, it is a splendid torch that you should make burn as brightly as possible before handing it on to future generations. Martha, we thank you for being that light that shone so brightly in all of our lives, for sharing your love so generously. And now, as you join the saints in light, please know that we will do our best to carry that light forward into the next generation. Amen.
It's so good to see everybody here. So my husband Tom is on piano, our daughter Meg, vocals and guitar, and our son Ben on cello. So Camp Christian was, you know, her happy place, her favorite place in the world. And so we were doing this medley that they've come up with, and we're gonna put the words up there, and we would like everybody to please stand and sing along.
Stars to shine. Tell me why.
seated. Let us pray. Eternal God, receive all of the love and gratitude that is in this room at this moment. Receive the memories, the joy, the tears, the laughter, as well as the loss. For we know with great tears means that there has been great love. God, we praise you for that great company of all of those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. But today, we praise you for your servant Martha, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To her, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon her, and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, not made with hands but eternal in the heavens. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
He's a winner. We're going to keep him, and don't tell Nancy. I'm taking him home to Ohio with me.
Reverend Everhard,
yes.
Would you say this is one of the warmer Thanksgivings that you've experienced?
I would say it's probably the warmest that I've ever experienced. And we managed to have this because Megan and I were going to hear from windy, cold, blustery Chicago. It's snowing in Chicago today.
Is it?
Oh, yes.
No, he's not. The Reverend is lying.
We have loved you. Your parents and Dick and I have given you some special gifts. The first gift was the gift of life. Through our love, we gave you life. And then we loved you. Oh, how we loved you. And it shows by the kind of adults that you are.
Cut, guys.
Hark, hark, here's the song. You know, Dick, you've got a point.
Mississippi.
What are your thoughts so far?
Great.
Great. Great. And like we've never seen anything like it before in our lives.
Nothing like this in Ohio.
And we walk, walking to the town.
There once was a young man named Dick, whose hair was so red and so thick. There once was a young beauty named Martha, whose hair was redder than an Irish setter. When Martha met Dick, he was smitten. If love bugs could bite, he was bitten. Now 50 years have passed, and they've gone by so fast. But the vows that they pledged to love, honor, and cherish are as strong today as the sequoias, and she'll never perish. Yeah.
Whoa! Goodbye.
So any thoughts on how well you were feted for your 50th?
I thought it was the most perfect celebration that could have ever been. Thanks.
We're too busy to say goodbye. We're never too busy to say goodbye. Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye. Goodbye. Goodbye.
Thanks for a great trip.
See you later. Bye. Any final words?
Take care of Tom, take care of Nancy, take care of him.
See ya.
Safe travels.
Bye. Bye, Meg. Bye, Robbie.
Bye, guys.
Thank you.
sometimes God calls us to sing through our tears, I invite you to stand as we honor Martha and offer our praise and worship to God as we sing our final hymn together, How Great Thou Art. After the conclusion of the blessing and benediction, we invite you to remain where you are until we dismiss you. We would love to have you join the family for the reception that's been prepared in the fellowship hall. You can get there by exiting through the doors in the back and going down the staircase, or if you prefer the elevator, you can exit through these doors to my right, and just down the hall is the elevator. And now, my friends, may we leave this place with love in our hearts. Know that the one who made you loves you just as you are. Know that in Christ Jesus, life and light have come into the world and conquered darkness and death. Walk in the light. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.